Good afternoon, all of you. Today we will discuss about Unit 16 and Unit 17. This is the last class of BHIC 131. The Unit 16 is Agrarian Settlements, Agrarian Society, Expansion of Trade and Urban Centers. Peninsular India, that is South India, area of land surrounded by water, that is west by Arabian Sea, east by Bay of Bengal, and in the north, Vindhya and Satpura ranges. The aim of this unit is to discuss the spread of agrarian settlements in the Deccan and South India from 200 BC to 300 BCE. We will also discuss briefly the different dimensions of the expansion of trade and urban centers in South India during the affirmation period. The earliest evidence of cultivation in peninsular India is traced back to the latter phase of New Stone Age, which is dated in the first half of 2nd millennium BCE. The New Stone Age people cultivated millets like ragi and bajra, and also pulses like green gram and horse gram. Making terraces on the slopes of hills was an important feature of the element of New Stone Age, and cultivation was limited to the trade fields. Rice was found in peninsular India roughly around the beginning of first millennium BCE, which is the starting point of Iron Age in the south. Spread of rice cultivation took place in Deccan, the South India during the Iron Age. The earliest of the Iron Age settlements are seen in upland areas. Introduction of iron did not bring any sudden change in the technique of cultivations. Technological advancement came later with the introduction of iron plowshares. This coincided with a concentration of settlements in the river valleys and of bullocks to the plow, and extensive use of iron plowshares resulted in the expansion of an area under cultivation and an unprecedented increase in agricultural productions. A remarkable change occurred later in the agrarian sector with the beginning of the practice of donating village land to religious beneficiaries such as Buddhist monasteries and the Brahmanas. They had better knowledge of seasons and a ability to predict weather. Grants of lands of monks and brahmanas resulted in coming in non-cultivating groups in the agrarian sector. So we identify three phases of the spread of agrarian settlements in early South India. First phase of primitive agriculture with a low-level technology in which cultivation was confined to all slopes. Then second phase characterized by plow agricultural with considerable advancement in the technology and spread of cultivation to river valleys. The third phase, which witnessed introduction of iron cultivation group into the agrarian sector that were endowed with better knowledge of seasons, managerial capacity and aids of for method of cultivation. Then forms of subsistence, that is maintaining or supporting. The forms of subsistence or supporting were determined by several factors such as geographical location, nature of terrain, material culture, and level of technology of the given region. Primitive techniques linger for long in some pockets, while some other areas advance in material production and social development. Diverse forms of subsistence are more visible in the region of Tamil Nadu. You will read in the subsequent unit that the early Tamil Sangam poem speaks of five ecozones. The term of Tinai and the subsistence pattern of each ecozone was quite distinct. There were Kurinji, the hills and forests, the Mulai, the pasture lands with low hills and thin forest, Marutam, the fertile agricultural plains, Natal, the sea coast, and Palai, the arid zone. Mulai or Kurinji tracts could become an arid zone in scoring summer. Kurinji tracts had forest tribes who were various known as Urabar, Betar, etc. Their main occupations were hunting and collecting forest produce like bamboo, rice, honey, and goods. The practice slash and burn cultivation on hill slopes and produce millets and pulses. They used various tools such as spears, sickles, and iron tipped hoes. जंगल को पोड़ी से माने चाष करूथले एवं सेटा कोहंती स्लैश एंड बर्न कल्टीवेशन ऑन हिल स्लोप्स एंड प्रोड्यूस मिलेट्स एंड पल्सेस दैट यूज्ड वेरियस टूल्स दैट इज कॉल्ड स्पेयर्स सिकल्स एंड आयरन टिपर्ड होस सच हिल ट्रैक्स वेयर प्लेसेस वेयर पीपर एंड अदर स्पाइसेस वेयर ग्रोन इन प्लेंटी दे आर वेल लिटरली रेफरेंस टू द कल्टीवेटर ऑफ पीपर एंड फैसिलिटीज फॉर वाटरिंग द गार्डन्स Pasture of the Mulai were occupied by cowherds who were known as Etias or Idias. Their source of livelihood was cattle rearing. They exchanged dairy products. They took practice shifted cultivation and produced millets, pulses, and lentils. The Marutam or agrarian areas were mostly in fertile river valleys, which were suitable for wetland cultivation of paddy and sugar cane. People who were called Pujavaras, meaning plowmen, engaged themselves in plow agriculture and produced considerable surplus of paddy. Paddy means phala, dhana phala, jyom. Karanti. People of other initiatives depends on the Marutam tracks for rice, their staple food. The Nandal people who were known as Paratavas were engaged in fishing and salt producing. They exchanged fish and salt for earning their livelihood. The Palai Chon was a seasonal phenomena of summer during which cultivation was not possible due to scarcity of water. Therefore, there were some people in the region who took to wayside robbery and cattle lifting. Salt merchants and dealers in other articles often passed through Palai regions in caravans that were often plundered by people who belong to the Marabar groups. From the above discussion, following forms of livelihood can be listed. That is called hunting and gathering forest produce, cattle rearing, plow agriculture, then fishing and salt making, and wayside robbery. केते प्रकार लोक केमिति जीविका निर्वाह करि चलुथले सेटा ए टेबुल रे दिया हिचि hunting and gathering forest producers, then cattle rearing, then plow agriculture, then fishing and salt making, and wayside robbery. Chori kori ki semane peta poshana koruthile. Then the chart in page number 395, that is region, geographical features, inhabitants and occupations, Kurinji, hill and forest, then Mulai, pasture land with low hills and thin forests, then Marutam, river valley and plains, then Natal, seaport, then Palai, arid zone, transformation of the heat tracks of pasture land in summers. Inhabitants is a hunters and gatherers. Then Mulai is a seafarers and iron and italiar. Then Marutam is a cultivators, Ujvars and Velar. Then Natal is a fisherman, Parvatwar. Then Palai is a robbers and Anar Marabar. Then spread of agriculture. Agrarian settlements. An increase in population is a notable change from New Stone Age in Iron Age in the Deccan and South India. This increase is reflected in the number of the Iron Age sites. As a result of this change, there is a spread of settlements from upland area of fertile river valley and a transmission from partly cattle rearing and partly shifting cultivation to settled agricultural economy. Then, page number 396. The concentration of settlements in the river valleys, a certain level of craft specialization, then extensive use of iron tools and implements, then extensive use of iron tools and implements, the new technology of the iron plowshare, then management of minor irrigational facilities, and a change from the dry land crops to a more surplus yielding wetland crop of paddy. Archaeological sites which suggest that Kanjas are settled all over South India. They are generally known as megalithic sites. Megalithic literally means big stone. The megaliths are associated not with actual settlements of the people, but with the burial sites in the form of stone circles. around the graves from inhabitational sites such as Tirukampulia, Algarai, etc. also have been brought to light, but they are very rare. Beginning of the megaliths are traced about 1000 BCE, but in many cases they are dated in the 5th to 1st century BCE. मृतक मानक जो पोती दिहला से बड़ बड़ पथर खंड गुड़ाक रखा होता दैट इज कॉल्ड बुरियास दैट इज कॉल्ड मेगालिथ साइट दैट इज ए बिग स्टोन एंड वी हैव फाउंड सम आर्टिकल्स लाइक ह्यूमन बोन्स वेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ पोटरी इंक्लूडिंग द कैटेस्ट ऑफ ब्लैक एंड रेड वेयर इनस्क्राइब पॉट शेयर्स टूल्स एंड वेपन्स ऑफ आयरन बीड्स एंड ऑर्नामेंट्स कॉल ऑब्जेक्ट्स एंड सेवरल अदर थिंग्स आम जो बुरियाल कहला ए बुरियाल मध्यर कौन पाइछु ह्यूमन बोन्स वेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ पोटरी देन पॉट शेयर्स देन टूल्स एंड वेपन्स ऑफ आयरन लुहारे निर्मित टूल्स एवं वेपन्स गुड़ाक अस्त्र शस्त्र बीड्स एंड ऑर्नामेंट्स अलंकार गुड़ाक एंड पॉट ऑब्जेक्ट्स एंड सेवरल अदर थिंग्स घर जिनिष उपकरण गुड़ाक आम पाइछु इट इज फ्रॉम दिस मेगालिथिक रिमेन्स दैट वी नो अबाउट द मटेरियल कल्चर ऑफ द एग्रियन सेटलमेंट से समय कौन कौन व्यवहार करते से गुड़ाक आम जानपरू दे तमिलहम एग्रीकल्चर इन तमिलहम एवं चाष तमिलहम कौन लिखाई चाष विषय दैट इज द एग्रीकल्चर इन तमिलहम वाज कैरियड ऑन विद द हेल्प ऑफ आयरन प्लाउशेयर लुहा नंगल स्पेयर्स एंड सिकल्स आर ऑल्सो यूज फॉर डिफरेंट एग्रीकल्चर पर्पजेस ब्लैकस्मिथ्स न्यू द मेटलर्जी ऑफ आयरन से टाइम रे ब्लैकस्मिथ पालुरा से केमिति लुहार उपकरण मान बना हुए सेटा से जानिथिले मेटलर्जी ऑफ आयरन एंड सम साइट्स हैव यर्लीड कॉमर्स यूज्ड फॉर आयरन स्मेल्टिंग एवं लुहा को ततई सेतिले बहुत गुड़ा उपकरण बना होतला एंड आयरन स्लग्स आल्सो हैव बीन ऑब्टेंड फ्रॉम सच साइट्स आयरन टिप प्लाउ इन नेसेसरी फॉर डीप प्लाउइंग फॉर राइस एंड सुगरकेन लैंड नीडेड डीप प्लाउइंग धान एवं आखु पई भितरु हल करबा जरूरी पड़ी थाए से गुड़ाक लक्ष्मी गुड़ाक तैयारी करते लुहारे निर्मित लुहा नंगल दूज प्लाउ इज एटेस्टेड बाय लिटरेचर एंड इनस्क्रिप्शन द डीलर इन प्लाउ शेयर फर्चर एज ए डोनर इन केव इनस्क्रिप्शन इन तमिलहम एवं आम इनस्क्रिप्शन से बुलक्स एंड बफालोस अरेंज एवं बुलक्स एवं बफालोस मान को भी प्लाउ रे व्यवहार करा जाउतला एंड इम्प्लॉयमेंट ऑफ ब्रॉड एनिमल्स कंबाइंड विद द यूज ऑफ द प्लाउ मेड एग्रीकल्चर ऑपरेशन एंड एफिशिएंट देन इरिगेशन फैसिलिटीज चाष पई पानी निहाती जरूरी इट टाइम बाय लोकल कल्टीवेटर्स एंड एट टाइम्स किंग्स एंड चिप्टेंस रिवर वाटर वाज चैनलाइज्ड टू द फील्ड्स रिमेन्स ऑफ एन एंशियंट रिजर्वर वर डिस्कवर्ड नियर कावेरीपट्टनम इन तमिलनाडु इरिगेशन वाज इंपोर्टेंट बिकॉज रेनफॉल वाज नॉट सफिशिएंट इन द रीजन Paddy and sugarcane were two important crops in the fertile marum fields. Pulses also were grown. It is known from the literature of the people that people had some knowledge of seasons, which was necessary for successful cultivation. Then Ujjabar and Vellore were cultivators of land. Ujjabar literally means ploughman. Nangal koruthwa ba chasa koruthwa. Look, and Vellor means master of soil. One of the sources of the labor for agriculture was the group of ploughmen. Atiyar and Henai Vellor are also mentioned as working in the fields. Atiyar probably means slave, and Henai Vellor means working, earning wages. Details about wage rates and other conditions of labor are not known. Limitation of the Aryan settlement to sufficient different group of functions like that is called blacksmiths, carpenters, guards, dancers, magicians, priests and monks. Then Deccan, that is called South India. There is an overall increase in the number of settlements in Deccan in the river basins, on coast and on the plateau during the Satavahana period, 1st century BCE to 3rd century CE. The Godavari Valley had largest number of settlements. Material culture of the Satavahana settlement showed some improvement for that of the megalithic settlements of Deccan. The tools and implements included plowshares, sickles, spears, axes, and arrowheads. Hoe continued in the develop, pitch, but it was a properly socketed iron ore was available in the areas of Krimanagar and Warangal. Iron working in this area is indicated as early as the Megalithic period. Gold working also attested to a Deccan in the Satavahana period. These developments show that metallurgy had progressed in these areas. Irrigation facilities were known in the form of tanks and wells. Water wheels was used for lifting water. Digging tanks and wells was considered to be notorious act. Some rulers are placed in the inscription as the matters of tanks. जलसेचन करबा पई कुआ कुड़ा होतला नदी बंध योजना गुडा करा होतला एवं व्हील द्वारा चक द्वारा पानी कोड़ा होतला. द पीपल ऑफ डेकान हैड नॉलेज ऑफ पेडी ट्रांसप्लांटेशन. धान पुणी की धान को उफाड़ी ताकु जो जगा हुए पेडी ट्रांसप्लांटेशन कहा जाए ताकु. The river basin of Godavari and Krishna became extensive rice producing regions in first two centuries of the common era. Cotton was grown in black soil areas and the cotton produce of Andhra became famous even in foreign countries. Cultivation of coconut trees went a long way in the development of coastal areas. Plantations of mango tree and some other trees of timber are also here in the different parts of the Deccan. The source of labor in the Deccan included wage labor and slaves. It was written in the Periplus of the Athenian Sea states that slaves were brought from Arabia. This clearly shows that there is a sharp distinction and satisfaction in society. Distinction between high and low was prevalent in Tamilaham. The high group consisted of rulers and chieftains and the valor and valir section who were master of the land. The low section consisted of ordinary peasants, guards and dancer workers, etc. The distinction was more crystallized in the Deccan, where a fusion of indigenous development and the northern ideal and identity took place in an earlier stage than ownership rights. Social distinction on the basis of wealth and property takes us to the problem of ownership rights. In a far south, we have seen that there were some valor group who were master of the soil. This seems to suggest possession of land rather than work on other's land or for wages. Occasionally, the chieftains or granted poor settlements to their fighters and birds. There were Dharpati householders who were both landowners and merchants. According to an inscription, Usabhadatta, the son-in-law of Khadrapa ruler Nahapana over Western Deccan. Khadrapa ruler Nahapana of Western Deccan pursued a plot of land from a Brahmin and donated it to Buddhist Sangha. This was possible because of the fact that land could be owned privately. From this deal, the private owner received 40,000 Kharapana coins. Satavahana kings donated plots of land and even village to religious beneficiaries. Then revenue and surplus extension. Through an organized mechanism, in this section we will discuss land revenue and its collection. That is the revenue from agriculture. Tamil literature mentions Irai and Thirai as the two types of contribution received by the chieftains. The Irai appears to have been a more regular contribution and the Thirai tribute. That is called paragraph first, page number 400. That is called Irai and Thirai. Irai is a appears to have been a more regular contribution and the Thirai is a tribute. Unfortunately, we do not have much information from contemporary records about the rate and mode of collection of revenue. The revenue system was probably more regular in Deccan under the Satavahanas, but again, there also be details are not very clear. We are about some names of taxes like Kara, Deya, Meya, and Bhaga. The actual significance of these terms or the amount of revenue claimed by the state are not known. The donation of village to Buddhist Sanghas and Brahmanas included revenues from donated villages. In such cases, some immunities are mentioned. These immunities were against entry by king soldiers for controlling any sort of fees, Second is the against where officer taking possession of particles from the village, and this you show that ordinary villagers had to pay some contribution of money or articles to soldiers when they came to the village. And second, the soldiers were authorized to collect revenue. It appears that in some Satavahana regions, the rural area where under the Golamika, who was in charge of small military unit, Golamika, small military unit, and when land was granted to Buddhist monasteries of the Brahmana, the state had to guarantee that their rights were not interfered with by the troops operated in rural areas. Then modes of acquiring and distributing resources in Tamil Nadu. How did the resources reach the hands of those who required them? Under a well-organized system, state system, the modes of appropriations were regularized according to rule and customs. Several methods of distribution of resources were prevalent in the agrarian settlements in Tamil Nadu, where we shall take up the important form of redistribution through gift. Gift was perhaps the most common mode of circulation of resources. As producer gave a part of his product to other for service rendered, gift of a rich meal or a piece of cloth. Gift of a rich meal or a piece of cloth was simple from redistribution. Fighting heroes were provided with feasts both before and after plunder and raid. Poor singers and dancing women who sang and danced in praise of chieftains traveled from court to court, eager to get a full meal and something to put on. At times, the gift objects included fine imported wine, silk cloths, and even gold ornaments in addition to the feast. Brahmin priests and warrior heroes often received villagers and castle in gifts by way of remuneration for their services. The gift of villagers to the Brahmanas accounts for the Brahman settlements in ancient Tamil Nadu. Acts of redistribution through gift were made by three groups of persons with wealth and power, namely the crown king, that is called Bhandar, the minor chieftain, that is called Bheli, and the well-to-do agricultural householder, that is called Bhelar, of the agrarian settlements. Then excessive extraction. In order to make distribution of gifts possible, it was necessary that resources were collected in a center which was the residence of the chiefs. Distribution of gifts from center was an important feature of redistribution. Pooling of resources often led to plunder and pillage of agrarian tracts. Grains and cattle were looted. What they could not carry was destroyed. Setting fire to peasant settlements, devastation of the harvesting field of enemies, and conversion of rich gardens to wasteland were some of the acts of the plunderers. The Marabha fighters of hill tracts and pasture lands were used by the chiefs to plunder settlements. The booty of such plunderers were redistributed among Marabha fighters and Brahmin priests by way of presentation and remuneration for expiratory rituals. The defenseless pilots of the peasants and the way they were terrorized and exploited are attested to by a number of songs of the Sangam authorities. The Pana singers sang in praise of the warlike qualities of the chieftains and the fighters. Then social organization, that is called society in Tamil Nadu. Society in ancient Tamil Nadu was essentially tribal in character, with its kinship organization, totem worship, and tribal cults and practices. In all the Japanese ecozones, tribal customs prevailed, but a change was gradually happening in the predominantly agricultural region. In this region, social organization was becoming complex. This was characterized by the gradual breaking up of old kingship ties and the introduction of the Brahminical Varna concept. Social stratification or inequality between different social groups appeared, and there was a broad distinction between different social groups appeared, and there was a broad distinction between high and low. The landed Bhelar and Bhelala peasants continued basic producing groups in the agrarian settlements. Then page number 402. Craft specialization was only rudimentary and subsidiary to agricultural productions. We hear of blacksmiths, that is called Kulhan, and carpenters, that is called Techan. Extended family was their unit of production. Weaving was another profession. Religious worship and cult practices of the village folk followed old tribal rituals. which necessitate the presence of ritual groups such as Velan, Ventolan, etc. They look after the supernatural elements and their management. However, society was not priest-dominated. There was considerable surplus which led to the prosperity of trading groups. They were known after the commodity in which they traded. Thus we hear of Umanar, salt merchants, Kola, vinegar, corn merchants or grain seller, then Aruvalli, vinegar, textile merchants, then Kon, vinegar, gold merchants. Towards the end of our period, the traders were accommodated with the Varna order which had by that time taken roots in the south Tolkappiyam, the earliest available work of Tamil grammar. Tolkappiyam, the earliest available work of Tamil grammar, portrays Tamil society as consisting of four Varna divisions. According to this text, the traders belong to the Vaishya group in deep south, especially in Madurai and Tiruvelli regions of the Pandya country. These traders are found associated with some heterodox religious group. They figure in early inscription of the region as donors of cave dwellings to the ascetics of Jaina or Buddhist order. The presence of ascetics of heterodox sects suggests that they had some followers in the region. It was quite natural that the chiefly groups established their centers in the agrarian tracts Marutam for the reason that surplus resources necessary for the sustenance of a non-producing group were available there only. The chieftains of Marutam agricultural tracts started claiming descent from Suryavansa or Solar Line or Chandravansa or Lunar Line as the Kshatriyas of North India. Chieftains exploited the peasants in agrarian settlements and extracted surplus with the help of Marabhar group of the peripheral regions. They often plundered the village. In the Sangam poems, war and warlike qualities of the warrior heroes are glorified. The functions of Pano singers and Virali dancers was to glorify the heroes and their heroism. Thus we find that society in the agrarian Marutam region of ancient Tamil Nadu was an amalgamation of old tribal practices and of Brahmanical ideas and ideology. Then society in the Deccan. In Deccan, all three major religion systems, Brahmanism, Buddhism and Jainism, enjoyed large following. Satavahana rulers extended their patronage to Vedic ritualism. For example, Naganika, an early queen of the Satavahana family, performed several Vedic rituals and made gifts mentioned in the Vedic texts. Jainism had some following in the region and some of the famous teachers of the Digambara sects flourished in this period. Konda Kundacharya, founder of the Mula Sangha, which became popular in South, lived in the region. Buddhism spread as a popular movement, and that religion could entail participation of a large number of followers, mostly traders and artisans. The Mahayana sects of Buddhism enjoy a good popularity. Ruling authorities, rich men and workers donated liberally to Viharas and Stupas. The temple of Buddhism is called Viharas and Stupas. Acharya Nagarjuna, the greatest exponent of Mahayana faith of Buddhism, flourished in the Deccan. Some foreign elements like Yavanas, Sakas and Pallavas embraced either Brahmanical or Buddhist religion. Through the period under study witnessed the function of various cultural elements in society. The rulers of foreign descent used Prakrit and later on Sanskrit in their inscription and even developed Indian personal and family names. The idea of fourfold division of society was familiar in Deccan. The practice of calling people according to their profession was popular. That is, Halaka means plowman, then Bolika means shepherd, then Vardaki, that is carpenter, then Polika, that is weaver, then Tilapisaka, that is oil presser, and Kamara, that is smith, blacksmith. Were some much professional levels, caste rules were much flexible, and this might be due to mixing up with foreign elements. Joint family system was the normal features of society. Male domination is clearly attested to its social life. Sometimes some women are found accepting the titles of their husbands, like Bhojiki, Maharathini, and Mahasenapatini, etc. The new elements and social change, page number 403. In the Deccan, some new elements made their first appearance in the Iberian order during the first census, CE. Satavahana and Kshatrapa rulers donated plots of land and even entire village of religious beneficiaries such as Buddhist monks and Brahmanas. Along with land, certain economic privilege in the form of the right to collect revenue from the village and to enjoy the right over mines were also transferred to the grantees. It appears that land grants included some fiscal and administrative rights over the peasants. The royal grants freed the village folk and obligatory payments to administrative functionaries and soldiers who visited the village. In the past, many grants to individuals had been temporary. The privileges and immunities sanctioned by the rulers and the grants of permanent right over land placed the religious beneficiaries in a highly powerful position. The land system and economy, which can be summed up as follows. In the first place, the religious beneficiaries became powerful authorities of the village, received by them with a new economic and administrative privilege in addition to the spiritual control which they exercised. Second, the land grants to monks and priests created a new class of non-cultivating landowners. Buddhist monks and Brahmin priests were not cultivators themselves. They had to employ others to work on their land. Actual tillers were those separated from the land and its produce. Third is, this type of private ownership abolished earlier collective rights over forests, pastures, fisheries and reservoirs. Fourthly, the beneficiaries enjoy right not only over land but also over peasants who worked on land. This led an erosion of the rights of peasants who became servile. Each developments in the Deccan have become prominent elsewhere in subsequent centuries. Finally, the practice of land grant contributed with several other features of the creation of a social order which is described by scholar as Indian feudalism. The types of trade. You have read about agrarian settlements and agrarian society in ancient Deccan. So far south, in this segment we will discuss other such aspects of economy as trade and urbanization which helped bringing about significant change in the society of early peninsula India or South India. The growth of trade and emergence of urban centers were not issue phenomena but were very much associated with other important changes taking place of the region which were generated by change in within society in different parts of peninsular India, caused by the growth of agriculture in major river valleys. To an extent, this was connected with iron technology of peninsular megalithic culture and with irrigation. In some parts, agricultural surplus appears to have been available. Then second, the Mauryan expansion of peninsular India led to the greater contact with the north and to movement of traders, merchants and others. This is suggested by the advantages of south route that is called Dakshinapatha, highlighted in the Arthashastra of Kautilya. There were further contacts along the coast. The earlier system and network of exchange in peninsula India today underwent major changes. To this end, another factor from the close of past century BC, demand for Indian goods brought merchants and ships from Roman world in the west in close contact with peninsular India. This provided a major impetus to the growth of trade and urban centers. All these again are associated with the growth of crops, specialization of growth of skill in producing crops items which are required of members of the society. Either in local exchange or for long distance trade, for example, different types of pottery, bead making, glass making, weaving of cloth all require different skills. Different aspects of the growth of trade and urban centers can be situated on the following heads. Exchange mechanism in local transactions and long distance trade. Second is organization of guilds. Third is transportation, storage and shipping. Fourth is means of exchange. Sixth is revenue from trade. Seventh is urban centers. And eighth is economic and social changes brought about by trade and urbanization. We have learned about the various geographical regions and their processes. Each region has something to exchange for items of other regions. At the same time, each of these regions lacked some items which were essential for its own society. Agricultural tracts produced food grains and sugarcane, but it had to depend on coastal areas for salt and fish. Coastal areas produced considerable surplus in salt and fish, but rice, the staple food, had to be brought from the areas of paddy cultivation. The hill ranges were rich in timber, spices, etc., but they had to depend on agricultural tracts and coastal areas for food grains and salt. The result of this kind of independence was not that exchange relationship had come to exist among various geographical regions. Some of the articles available in South India were required by other parts of the subcontinent and even by other countries and civilization. Contacts were established through land routes or sea routes by those distant countries, and necessary articles were produced. Those we can identify three levels of trade, that is local trade, second is long distance or overland trade, and third is long distance or overseas trade. One is local trade, second is long distance or overland trade, and third is long distance overseas trade. First is local trade, where the barter system was the most common mode of transportation in the context of local exchange. Most of the items of the barter were from immediate consumption, that is salt, fish, paddy, dairy products, roots, venison, honey and toddy were regular items of butter in far south. Salt was exchanged for paddy, paddy was exchanged for milk, curd and ghee, honey was given for taking fish oil and liquor, rice flakes were sugar cane, were given for venison and toddy. Very rarely luxury items like pearls and infant toss also appeared as items of butter. They were also butter for articles of consumption such as rice, fish, toddy, etc. Loan was not unknown in the barter system of Tamil South. A loan of a fixed quantity of an article could be taken to be repaired in the same kind and quantity at a later date. This was called kiruittipai. Kiruittipai. Exchange rates were not fixed. Petty beginning was the only method of fixing the price of articles. Paddy and salt were the only two items for which a set exchange was known in the part south. Salt was butter for an equal measure of paddy. In Deccan, under the Satavahana ruler, the use of coins was quite common. Even so, the contribution of butter need not be ruled out. Craft produce like pots, pans, coils, and trinkets. Trinkets were butter in rural areas. In the butter system of the far south, the following features can be noticed. Most of the items of exchange were of consumption articles. Second is, exchange was not profit oriented. Third is, as in the case of production, distribution also was subsistence oriented. Then long distance overland trade. Contacts in various pairs between the north and south Indian parts of India can be traced back at least 4th century BCE, not earlier. Resources of the regions which lay to south of the Vindhya Range were known to the north. Early Buddhist literature seems to refer to a route which ran from the Ganga Valley to the Godavari Valley. This was known as the Dakshina Patha. Kautilya, the author of Arthashastra, was written about the advantage of the southern route. According to him, the southern territories abounded in conchs, diamonds, pearls, precious stones and gold. Page number 407, second para. Moreover, this route passed through territories that were rich in mines and valuable merchandise. He says that this route was frequented by many during those days. The route touched many southern centers, including the city of Pratisthana, which was to become the capital of the Satavahanas at the latter date. Most of the items of this north-south trade were luxury articles such as pearls, precious stones and gold. Good varieties of textiles moved between north and south also. Perhaps a fine variety of silk came from Kalinga, modern Odisha. The name of this thin silk was Kalingan silk, evidently named after the place of its origin. This was an important item favored by the Tamil chieftains. The bears who sang in praise of chieftains received this silk cloth as a valuable present. The fine type of pottery called NBPW or Northern Black Polished Ware also found its way to the extreme south. Archaeologists have unearthed some NBP shears in territory of the early Pandyas. Besides the above items, some herbs and spices also were brought to the south. These included spikenard and malvathun, a herb for preparing ointment, which were shipped to the west. The northern traders also brought a large quantity of silver Panama coins. Panama coins in large hoards have been unearthed from different parts of South India. They bear testimony to brisk commercial contacts between North and the South. As the long distance trade with Northern India was mostly in luxury items, the benefits of the trade was enjoyed by a small section consisting of ruling elites and their men. Then, the long distance overseas trade. Indian items such as spices, precious and semi-precious stones, timber, ivory, and many other articles were in great demand in Western countries. The main source for these articles was South India. These articles were shipped to the West from very early times. Considering the bulk of transactions and the resultant profit direct trade with the Roman world, of which we have evidence from the close of the first century BC, proved to be very significant for the economy and society of Peninsular India. We shall identify two stages in the commercial contact of Rome with Peninsular India. An early stage with the Arabs as Mediterranean, Bhumadhya Sagar deiki Arabian manko sahita South India ro traders mane byabsaya korthile. And the second stage, which is direct contact, was established with the knowledge of monsoon winds. Jeuare pavan ro digo thae sei are se mane jahaj re byabsaya koriba pai jauthile. For a long period, navigation in the Arabian Sea was coastal. It was tedious and expensive. The Arabs had established a commercial connection with India, making the sea as a highway of trade before the beginning of the Common Era. Geographical position of the Arabs was favorable to them in enjoying the monopoly in east-west trade. They had some knowledge of wind system in the Arabian Sea, and they kept it a trade secret. Arabian mana prathama जो माने कि ट्रेड सिक्रेट जानिथिले एवं पवन रो दिग विषय जानिथिले समुद्र रे केते बेले केऊ पवन केऊ दिग को बहे तांकु वाणिज्य व्यवसाय करिवारे सहायता करथला. दे प्लेड अ रोल ऑफ मटेरियल एंड रेस्ट कंसिडरेबल प्रॉफिट आउट ऑफ द ट्रेड विथ पेनिनसुलर इंडिया. विथ द डिस्कवरी ऑफ अ मॉनसून विंड्स व्हिच इज अटेंडेड टू अ नेविगेटर नेम हेपालस, डायरेक्ट कांटेक्ट वाज एस्टैब्लिश्ड बाय द रोमन्स विथ इंडिया. नेविगेटर व नाविकरण ना थिला हेपालस. पेज नंबर 408 सेकंड पारा. डायरेक्ट कांटेक्ट वाज एस्टैब्लिश्ड बाय द रोमन विथ इंडिया एवं से रोम सहित भारत रो संपर्क स्थापन करथिले. ट्रेड एंड कॉमर्स वाणिज्य व्यवसाय करिया पई. दिस मार्क द बिगिनिंग ऑफ ए पीरियड ऑफ इंक्रीज इन कॉमर्स बिटवीन रोम एंड पेनिनसुलर इंडिया मे बेस्ड ऑन साउथ इंडिया. रोमन्स ब्रॉट टू द साउथ इंडियन पोर्ट्स their articles, which included both raw materials and finished products. The raw materials consisted of copper, tin, lead, coral, topaz, flint, glass, such a few materials for making beads. The finished products were best quality of wine, cloths of fine texture, fine ornaments, gold and silver coins, and different types of excellent pottery. A large number of articles were shipped by the Romans from Peninsular India to the west. We will identify the following categories among them. Spices and medicinal herbs like the pepper, spikenard, malvathun, cinnabar, that is, and precious and semi-precious stones such as beryl, agate, carnelian, jasper, and onyx, as well as shells, pearls, and tusks. Timber items like ebony, teak, sandalwood, and bamboo, and textile items of colored cotton cloth and muslin, as well dyes like indigo and lac. Among the above items of export, beads and textile were the finished goods. The Romans paid for Indian articles mainly in gold. A majority of the export items were locally available, and the collection of merchandise in the Deccan and South India was done by Indian merchants themselves. Wagons and pack animals were for transporting them to the ports. Bandar ko aniba jinis aniba pai wagons ba pack animals gura ko byabahar kara jauthila. The shipping of merchandise to the western lands was carried out mostly by foreign merchants through there were Indian maritime traders in Deccan and South India. South India had commercial connection with Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia. Important articles of this trade were some spices, camphor and sandalwood. Merchants of Tamil origin were probably in taking the initiative in this trade. Sri Lankan merchants came to Tamilaham also. There are inscriptions written in Tamil Brahmi characters which refer to those who came from Ilam or Sri Lanka or Ceylon. However, details of this trade are not known. Then aspects of commercial organizations. In small scale, local transactions quite often the producers were all dealers too. Fishing and salt making were done exclusively by the community of the Pathavaras mentioned in the Sangama literature as living in Natal or coastal region, and so they had to devote their whole time for these activities. Therefore, a different method was followed in the distribution of fish and salt. Fish were taken to neighboring areas of the sea coast by women folk of the fisherman family. They appeared in the place of village fairs and other rural gatherings. As an essential item, salt was in demand everywhere. A separate group took to the distribution of salt. Salt merchants were known as Umanasa in Tamilaham, Umanasa. In the coastal areas and neighboring village, the Umanasa or hawker girls carried salt in head, loads and barrels in mainly with paddy. What are with mainly paddy? Paddy is semane adan podan kurthle. Water system semane luna dothle, ebong luna bodla semane dhana ba gahama jeunta bi semane exchange kurthle. Then in the interior rural village, salt was taken by the Umanasa. Big bags of salt were transported in cars drawn by bullocks or horses. Ebong bahut gudae सगड़ गाड़ी रे एवं गथ साहय रे लुण व्यवसाय करा होतला. सॉल्ट मर्चेंट्स मूव्ड इन लार्ज ग्रुप्स. दिस सॉल्ट कैरावान्स वर कॉल्ड उमांचू. दे बार्टर सॉल्ट फॉर लोकल प्रोड्यूस. द उमांचू एक्टेड एज एन कलेक्टर्स ऑफ मर्चेंडाइज फ्रॉम डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द रीजन. द उमानासा मूव्ड इन कैरावान्स विद देयर फैमिली. No organization other than the family is known to have existed among the salt merchants. Besides salt dealers, there were dealers in corn, that is pula vinegar, cloth, arubai vinegar, gold, brown vinegar, then sugar, ponita vinegar. Repeat, there were dealers in corn, that is pula vinegar, then cloth, arubai vinegar, then gold, corn vinegar and the sugar, ponita vinegar. That is page number 409. Then 410. In ancient cave inscription of Tamilaham, a donors of dwelling places to some ascetics, this indicates that they were affluent. Details of their trade and organization are not known. There is a single epigraphic reference to traders' organization of Tiruvelai in the deep south, the member of the which are described as Nikamator, meaning the member of the Nigama or a guild or a merchants group. In Tamilaham, the organization of traders was perhaps a rare thing, but in the Deccan merchants, guilds or associations were a regular phenomenon. Another route ran from the western hilly region to Kanchipuram, which was a seat of a local chieftains and a famous city of the coast east coast. Salt caravans and other merchants were the travelers who travel these routes. The caravans moved in large groups. Besides merchants, very often wandering parts, dancers, messengers, mendicants, etc. moved from place to place, also such routes. These groups choose to join the caravans because the journey was often hazardous. In territories under the Satavahana, the picture was somewhat different. The main route to the Deccan from the north came from Ujjaini to the city of Pratisthana or Paithan, the capital of Satavahana. From Pratisthana, it passed across the Deccan plateau to lower Krishna Valley and then went further south to reach the famous southern cities of Kanchi and Madurai. A network of roads developed early in the common era from this old route linking the producing area in the interior with inland markets and towns and the port towns on the western coast. The fertile river valleys of Godavari and Krishna also had such network of routes to connect the interior with the coastal towns. It is interesting to note that some of the famous ancient Buddhist cave sites and religious centers in the Deccan were situated on such trade routes. These religious centers were helpful in many ways to the merchant caravans. Besides providing food and shelter, they even issued loans. The rulers also showed interest in conditions of these routes. They donated liberally to Buddhist religious establishments which were located on the routes. They constructed rest houses at port towns and established water cells on the routes. Officials also were appointed for their upkeep. Unfortunately, information is not available regarding the policing on such roads. Often the roads have to cross over rivers. Ferries were established at such points and toll was also collected from merchants. Some of the ferries were toll-free. Due to familiarity with a long coastline and several river systems, navigation both on sea as well as rivers was known to South Indians. Smaller boats were used for ferry crossing and river navigation. Navigation on the sea was made possible by construction and use of bigger vessels. Navigation in Tamilham was mainly coastal. There were some trade connections with Sri Lanka. Sri Lankan is called as Ilam. Traders figure in some ancient inscriptions of South India. Similarly, Tamil traders appear as donors in some early inscriptions of Sri Lanka. This evidence shows that traders from Tamilham participated in maritime trade. The Deccan too had merchants who were particularly engaged in sea-borne trade. Ships fitted out of Brahmaparikacha are known from literature of this period. Merchants of peninsular India, particularly those of the Deccan, participated in foreign trade. The presence of some Indian traders in Egypt and Alexandria is attested by foreign writing of this period. Royal authorities were aware of the importance of maritime trade. They provided facilities for the traders. Ships arriving at Brihukhacha were collected by local boats and conducted to separate berths and docks. In far south, the big chieftains of Tamilham encouraged sea trade in different ways. Chieftains of the choto choto jo raja gudako thile nijo nijo choto choto rajya re semanku chieftains kaha jutla sete bele raja no thile raja mankor poton hei jitla ebong eta south india ba peninsular india ro se somoy ro banijyo byabosha kemiti utla se bisoye ame poruche. Then storage facilities were provided and protection of goods was also arranged at the waterhouse. Seas grown trade in the far south as well as in the Deccan shows some features of what is described as administrative trade by some modern scholars. The difference between the two regions is that the features are more prominent in Deccan, whereas in Tamilham they are at the rudimentary level. Then exchange facilities. The question of facilities for transportation, storage and shipping is relevant particularly in the context of long distance trade in which the movement of bulk items of a problem. In the far south, paper, paddy and salt were main items with required movement in bulk. In western Deccan, timber also was a bulk item of the demand from the west. Pack animals and cars were used for inland transport. In Tamilham, there were several routes which connected interior tracks with the settlements in river valleys, ports, towns and seas of rulers. One such route went from western areas of the Kaveri Valley to the Cholapur town of Kaveri, Kaveri Muttapattinam. A town seems to have had a guild, Nigama. As guild had a elderman, that is called Sethi. We have already discussed about Sethi, that is the second of the king. First is the king, then the Sethi, as a richest person, as a wealthy person. During 6th century BCE and its own office, the organization of traders acted as a bank. Then it received deposits and lent out money. Guilds of weavers, potters, oil pressers, bamboo workers, beggaries, etc. known from the inscription of Deccan. The guild as a working unit was more efficient than the family unit. Besides the strength of unity, Guild was capable of providing all sort of help to its member, including financial assistance. Further, the individual member was revealed from the responsibility of the finding out a customer. Though the territories under Satavahana had a comparatively advanced system in the organization of trade, then coins as medium of exchange through barter was the most common mode of transaction. The use of coins as a means of exchange became current in the period of that are discussing. They can broadly be divided into two broad categories: local coins of different varieties and Roman coins. Local coins of different varieties. Local coins of different varieties were prevalent in different regions in peninsular India. Then ancient Tamil literature speaks about some of them, such as Kasu, Kanam, Pon, and Ven. Page number 411, then 412. But ancient coins which may correspond to those names have not been discovered. In the Deccan scripture, referred to the use of Kahapanas, which were silver coins locally minted, and Subarnas, which referred to gold coins either of the Romans or the Kushanas. Actual coins of different varieties and minted in different metals like lead, protein or copper mixed with tin and other metals, copper and silver were in use. The earliest among them were Panjma coins, which, as you have learned in a previous unit, came to be minted in Northwest and North India from 6th to 5th century BCE onwards. In peninsular India, two different varieties of Panjma coins were minted in different regions. Other varieties of coins manufactured by using other techniques like casting, localities of members of the important Marathi and other families standing minting coins in their own name. To these were added coins of the Satavahana rulers minted in different metals, possibly from 1st century BC onwards. In northern Deccan, Gujarat, Malwa and adjacent regions, silver coins of the Satrapas were in the great demand. So between 2nd century BC and the close of 2nd century CE, the largest variety of local coins were minted and were in circulation in peninsular India. Then Roman coins. Ancient Tamil literature refers to Yavana, that is called Forana, that is called Romans. Ship bringing large quantities of gold to Tamilaham to be exchanged for paper. Gold Morichapai. Suna Mudra Dya Utla. The Roman Emperor Tiberius wrote in the Senate in 22nd CE that the wealth of the empire was being drained up to foreign lands in exchange of petty things. That is called the Roman Emperor Tiberius wrote to the Senate in 22nd CE that the wealth of the empire was being drained up to foreign lands in exchange of petty things. From 1st century CE, Pliny, author of the Natural History, complained that every year a hog amount of Roman wealth went out to India, China and Arabia for luxury articles. These statements are well supported by a large number of Roman coins found in hoards in various places of peninsular India like Andhra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. Most of the coins belong to a period between 1st century BC and 3rd century CE. This shows that Roman contacts with peninsular India was mixed during this period. Roman coins are mostly in gold and silver coins, and also copper coins are extremely rare but not altogether unknown. That is, gold and silver is more than copper coins. Roman money was brought to purchase items which were dear to the Westerners. These items could not be produced by exchanging Roman things in gold. Big transactions were thrown by means of gold coins. Silver coins were used for comparatively small purchases. Small scholars are of the view that Roman gold was accepted not as coin but as a bullion. It is also held by certain scholars that Roman gold was used for ornaments by South Indians. Some numismatics have maintained that Roman coins had the Panjma coins were current in the countryside by sight. Roman coins were of roughly the same weight as Panjma coins. In some hoards, they are found along with Panjma coins. Both types are equally worn out, and this suggests that they were current for a long time before they were placed in hoards. Imitation of Roman coins were also current in South India, especially on the Coromandel coast, where there were some Roman trading stations. These imitated coins may have been manufactured to satisfy the needs of such colonies. The revenue from trade. Collection of revenue as a regular source of income to the treasury depends on several factors, including efficiency of the government. Political developments in different regions in peninsular India in our period were not uniform in character, so the revenue system also varied from region to region. Toll was collected for merchandise movement on pack animals and cars. This toll was known as ulku, a derivative of the Sanskrit term shulka, meaning toll. This seems to indicate that the idea of toll was borrowed from the north. However, all the crown chieftains and lesser chieftains of the south are said to have been interested in trade, especially with the Yavanas, evidently with an eye on the income from commerce. In the Cholaport town of Kaveri Muthipatnam, there were Chola rulers against to affix Chola emblem of the tiger on the merchandise. Toll was also levied on articles. Detailed information about this aspect is sadly not available. Further north in the territory of the Satavahanas, taxation seems to have been more regular and systematic. Toll was collected on each item of trade. Custom duties and various tolls were levied on merchants at each major town. The rates of such duties and toll are not specified anywhere. Ferry duties were another source of income. Usavadatta, the son-in-law and representative of the Khatrapa ruler Nahapana of Western India, is said to have made arrangements for toll-free ferries on some rivers. Revenue was received in kind or cash. Artisans had to pay tax on their produce. Drabya kimba point re semane nauthile cash or kind. From this fragmentary formation, one can only say that it's called Karukara. Karu means artisans and para means tax. Karukara. Artisans means Karukara. Karu means artisans and para means tax. From this fragmentary information, one can only say that the ruling authority derived considerable income from trade and commerce. Then, weight and measures. A developed system of exchange requires regular weights and measures. When it is possible to weigh, measures and count objects which one is buying or selling, exchange becomes both easy and efficient. The buyer and the seller do not have to feel uncertain about the quantity or size of the objects brought or sold. In Deccan, where dealing with different kind of items in the trading centers was a regular practice, the idea of exact measurements must have been prevalent. Coins were issued in different denominations and land was measured in terms of nivartans. Ma and Bheli were measures of land in the far south. Ma and Bheli were measures of land in the far south. Paragraph 415. Here grain was measured in Abanam, that is grain. Grain was measured in Abanam. Probably a large measure in the context of paying tribute, small measures such as Nali, Ulukku and Alukku were also known. Weight was known by means of balance. Balance was perhaps a rod with mass on it. Even minute weight would be balanced. Here we are told about weighing gold on a balance. In day-to-day transaction, the linear measurement was expressed in terms of length of gingerly grain, that is called paddy grain, finger and hand, then urban centers. The rise and growth of a number of urban centers, we will begin with centers of the Deccan, where the features of urban growth are clearly visible. Western and eastern coast has several port towns. In the coastal Andhra region, in the delta of the Godavari and Krishna, there are some important centers. Ships sailed from there to the many Malay Peninsula and eastern archipelago. The western port towns of Bhrigu Kaccha, that is called Bruch, Sopara and Kalyan, however, appear to be older and more important in the early phase of Indo-Roman trade. In the interior, there are big and small urban centers like Pathisthanam, Paithan, देन टागरा और टेल, भोगवर्धन और भोगडन, देन करहतक और करत, देन नासिक, देन विजयंती, देन धन्यकटक, देन विजयपुरी एंड नागार्जुनी कोंडा. We may identify following factors which led to the rise of the centers which were distinct from ordinary rural settlements. An agriculture interlands capable of producing necessary surplus for the consumption of different social groups living in urban centers. Emigrants of such groups as those of traders, artisans and handicraftsmen who were not directly involved in food productions. Then emergence of guilds which organized the activities of traders and craftsmen. Then facilities for collection of commodities required in local and foreign exchange and development of shipping. Then a ruling class capable of challenging surplus to the centers and also providing help and protection. Then emergence of a monetary system. Then spread of writing, which is essential for accounting and registering. Then functionally the urban centers belong to different categories, that is called administrative centers, collection centers, cantonments, center for foreign trade, markets and manufacturing centers. However, most of these functions would be carried out of a single urban centers. Three distinct types of centers can be identified in Tamilaham, mostly on the basis of reference in the Sangam poems and those literary writings, and to some extent on the basis of archaeology. That is called rural exchange centers, inland market town centers, and port town centers. In the process of exchanging articles for subsistence between different tenaced ecozones were emerged several centers as a point of contact. These contact points were upon junction of traditional routes. Inland towns like Uriyar near modern Tiruchirappalli, then Kanchi, that is called Kanchipuram, and Madurai and markets. Madurai had markets, they too had not developed into full-fledged urban centers. Then Patinams, port towns, were more active under the patronage of the rulers. There were several such centers on east coast, Puhar or Kaveri, Mahapatnam on the Cholas, then Arikamedu, Porahi of the Pandyas on the west coast, Mujri and Tandis of the Cheras, Baker and Nalanda. They were the centers of maritime trade, and some of them like Arikamedu had colonies of the Yavanas. Mijris was a busy center with a port crowded with a sheep of all kinds, with large warehouse and markets. Since the emphasis of trade at the port towns was a luxury item, so Patinams were not closely linked with the local exchange network. They remained as pockets of foreign trade with mainly the rulers and rich as inclinate. The growth of these centers was to the result of external trade. With the decline of external trade, these centers too dwindled and disappeared slowly. The nature of these urban centers was through strategic-wise absence of linkage with local exchange networks, craft specialization, and support of such institutions as monastery and guild. The impact of trade and urban centers on society. Early trade and urban development do not seem to have brought about very fundamental changes in the social life of Tamilaham. Local exchange was subsistence-oriented. Long-distance trade was mostly in luxury goods, which did not circulate beyond kingship circles of the chieftains and their men. Individual merchants' wealth and prosperity, as seen in their gifts to monks, were not very impressive. Craftsmen and traders were not organized in guilds. They functioned together as members of a family or as close relatives. They thus acted only according to the norms of the kingship, based on relations of a tribal nature. In Deccan, the situation was different. Participation of local trading groups was necessary also for long distance trade. So the advantage of this trade filtered down to the other levels of society. The wealth and prosperity of the artisans, craftsmen and traders are reflected in their donations to Buddhist monasteries. The guilds, organizations of artisans and traders were instrumental in breaking old kingship ties and introducing a new type of relations in productions of handicrafts and in trading ventures. The relationship between rulers, commercial groups and Buddhist monastic establishment was responsible in introducing important changes in society and economy in the Deccan. That is called South India. And then unit 17, growth of Tamil language and literature. The last chapter of this book, growth of Tamil language and literature. In the previous unit, you learned how settlements grew up, agriculture basins expand and trade flourish in Tamilaham. Then in this unit, you will be made familiar with the growth of Tamil language and literature. Tamil had become a literary language. That is a full-blown language with its own system of writing, at least. But 3rd century BC, if not earlier, earlier evidence of the Tamil literary tradition, that the tradition of writing in the language comes from Tamil Brahmi inscription in Jaina and Buddhist case from the Tamil Brahmi hill. These inscriptions are in the form of labels of persons of bodies who donated the caravans. The major centers of these label inscriptions are Atrapatti, Mayalam, Madurai, Korungalakti, Melur, Madurai, then Kongarapuliyama Pulam, Madurai, and Ajakamalai, Madurai. That is the centers of these Brahmi inscription or Brahmi literary source. Many Tamil words along with local adoptions of Sanskrit and Prakrit, Pali occur in these labels. Nigamatar, the member of Nigaman, and Bonikon, the who is engaged in Bonikam, that is trade, may be cited as two examples of the Tamil adoptions of Sanskrit words. It has to be noted that the Tamil language used in these labels was different from the literary Tamil. The difference was due to Jaina and Buddhist immigrants from the north who were introducing a considerable number of Sanskrit and Prakrit Pali terms. These terms were adopted to suit the linguistic structure of Tamil language. The combination of names of persons, professions, and places that figures inscription gives clues to the currency of Tamil as a literary language. The period of this label inscription are roughly between 200 BC and 300 CE. Tamil heroic poems, popularly called the Sangaman literature, constitute major evidence of the old Tamil literary tradition. That is called heroic poems. The Tamil heroic poems are called the Sangama literature, since they were collected and classified by the Sangama, which was an academy of a scholar, a group of scholars. The poem by themselves were not the product of the Sangama. They were much earlier than the Sangama. History of the Sangama is clothed in legends. Tradition says that there were originally three Sangamas, among which the work of the last one alone have survived. Previously, it was believed that the Sangama were academic of court poets. But now it is a matter of consensus that they were constituted by the scholars in literature. The time lagged between the Sangama and the heroic poems shows that the name Sangama literature is a misnomer. By and large, the Tamil heroic poems were products of the fall. They signify and highlight the tradition of bards who roamed about singing and praise of their patron chiefs. However, all the poetic compositions were not of the wandering boats. Some of them were composed by scholarly poets who followed the bardic tradition. Kapilar, Paranar, Abayar, and Gautamanar were some of the well-known poets of the period. That is page number 424, para first. So not the literature of any particular social group, but part of a common way of life. Spanned over a few centuries, the poems reflect the gradual development of Tamil language and literature. They survived not in their original independent form, but as a classified anthologies of choice collections. Then there is a classification of Tamil literature. Now we are see the poems in the form of classified collection of specific poetic themes and conventions. That is called Pitu Gotai, the eight collections of poems, and Pottu Gotai, the term Adelie Art, are two categories of anthologies that comprise the heroic poems. Nari Nai, Kuruntu Koi, Era Kurunuru, Patiru Pattu, etc. are the few examples of anthologies grouped under Pitu Ko Gai and Mulu Pattu. Madhurkanch and Kurungu Pattu, etc. are the example of anthropologies under Puttu Pattu. The anthropologies are divided into Akam, dealing with themes and subjects experience like love or affection, and Puram, dealing with themes of objection like raid or plunder. Both the above categories of anthropologies comprise collection of poems and based on Akam and Puram themes. Akam Naru, a collection of 400 poems based on Akam themes, and Puranaru, a similar collection based on Puram themes, are two examples of the Pitu Gai category. In the same manner, there are examples of both Akam and Puram anthologies in the Puttumattu category. Apart from the heroic anthropology, the classified forum of Sangam literature includes the Tukulapiyam, a transist of Tamil grammar, and Pottini Kejakaru, the 18 dialectic text, also the famous Thirukkural by Thiruvallavar, each one of the 18 dialectic texts. Both Takapiyam and Pitten Kajapakku were composed after most of the Itugai and Potukutu poems had been composed. The direction and techniques of composition of the heroic anthropologies keep them distinct from other texts that are later than techniques of composition. The heroic poems were composed on the principles of oral metric literature. The features of oral composition are strangely similar all over the world. Use of stock phrases and expressions in the most important features of such compositions. Stock phrases or expressions are ready-made expressions or phrases current among the people of the times. Poets know the context of ready-made expressions, where to use them, and how in their poems. The poems are composed using set motifs or ready-made expressions in a formula that is orally transmitted and commonly shared by the boards of well-versed society. The set expression required for quoting the variety of context regular in the poems. For instance, if the context is the praise of chieftains, the series of talk comes like warrior of victorious lands, possessor of lofty chariots, chieftains of swift steeds, hero of eye-filling garlands, and so on follow. Obviously, however, the poet is the chieftains. These examples show that the bards are there to be master such ready-made expression and their context. Then the techniques of versification of oral poetry dependent on the general or common style and expression. It is technique of combining set phrases over with the poets as well as the society by and large has mastery. So there are repeated lines of them with marginal modification in different poems by different poets. The hereditary transmitted stock phrases leave the bulk of heroic poems full of old memory. This is one of the many hazards of dating the poems. There are problems of dating. The corpus of Sangam literature cannot be precisely dated owing to a series of problems. In fact, several periods are represented in the poems of Sangam and anthropologies. One is the period of actual composition and oral transmission, which was fairly long and spread over a few centuries from 2nd century BC to 3rd century CE. Next is the period of codification of the poems into anthologies, which is between 6th and 9th centuries. Another period is that of the commentaries, which are not earlier than 13th to 14th centuries. Tukulapiyam, the traditional grammatical treatise and its present form, is not earlier than 3rd century CE. Through basic parts of the text could be slightly earlier. All the Kejikaku texts belong to a period later than 3rd century CE. The great difficulty is dating Sangam literature is that it is hard to clarify sort out the earlier form, the latter portion, and they are all mixed up. Then the poetics, based on the Sangam literature, they have developed a fairly about set of poetic conventions. Through the poetic, as such, as a little letter, the rules and the convention of the compositions were part of the old Tamil poetic tradition. We have already noted that the Akam and Puram in the previous section. Akam is subdivided into five stages of love in relation to the five tinis. Each tinis or tinai is associated with a particular mood of love. For instance, Pola is associated with the sentiment of separation of the lovers. The Puram genre of poem says its own tinai situations and theories, context. There are so many as 9 tinis and 63 tinis with the poets put optional for the compositions. Both the Akam and Puram genres of poems followed the fixed conversion of H. H Akam poem had to follow the notion of Itnai, which had its own deity, biological organisms, subsistence pattern, musical instruments, and songs. Similarly, H Puram poem had to avoid by the restrictions associated with the variety of Tinis, situation of behavior. Then literary development. The Tamil literature tradition is independent of the classical Sanskrit literature tradition of India. It represents a parallel linguistic tradition in relation to Sanskrit. However, the development of Tamil language and literature was never a process in isolation. Even the earliest centrum of the Tamil literature contains influence of Sanskrit. The heroic poems and other Sangam works contain traces of Aryan culture. By Aryan culture, we mean Vedic ideals and institutions in this text or in this context. The tradition of Vedic rituals is well attested by the poems. Some of the bards like Gotamanar, Paranar, and Kapilar were Brahmanas. Gotamanar is mentioned to have officiated many Velvi or Yajna or Vedic sacrifice for his patron, Telkenju Kutumban. The Chera chief, the epic and Puranic ideas are also seen in Tamil heroic poems. While tracing the pattern, chiefs, the poets refer to the former participation in the Mahabharata battle. Many Puranic deities are acquainted to their Tamil counterparts. Mayan, the black god, well known in the poems as the Tamil counterpart of Krishna, is one example. But these influences never underestimated that were typical of the Tamil literary tradition. This original aspect of Tamil language and literature does not owe to Sanskrit for its origin, but its growth and development towards linguistic and literary perfection certainly owes to the influence of Aryan culture. The heroic poems and other work of the Sangam tradition testify widespread literary culture of early Tamilaham. They also indicate linguistic maturity achieved by the Tamils by 3rd century CE. And then other compositions are the basic parts of Tuklapiyam and some of the Hoja Kanpu text constitute the other compositions here. These are called the other compositions because they do not belong to the bardic tradition of heroic poems, but they are not far removed from the literary background on the bardic tradition. The Purla Dikaram part of Tuklapiyam that deals with the Akam and Puram convention of old Tamil is close to the period of heroic poems. Similarly, the Tinai text and works like Kevalbaji are relatively earlier. Through some scholars regarded the twin epics Silapadi Karam and Mani Meklai as contemporaneous to the heroic poem. They are identified as works of a much later period, that is Silpadi Karam and Mani Meklai, as contemporaneous to the heroic poem. They are identified as works of a much later period. And above all, the summary is the The Tamil literature is an art, it is constituted by you also learned about the main features of heroic poems, their techniques of compositions, and the problem of dating. Another point you learned was the level of literary and linguistic development of old Tamil. You could also understand how the works in old Tamil were classified and codified into anthologies during the Sangam period. That is your chapter number 70 is end. And you have to ask from question. This is a question hour. From unit 1 to 17, you have asked few questions. That the unit first is the sources of Indian history. That is three types of history sources. First is literary source, second is archaeological source, and third is foreign accounts. Then that is called archaeology. Unit two, archaeology is a source and provenant archaeological sites. That is archaeology. It divided into three parts. One is inscription, second is coins, and third is monuments. Then unit third is Indian history, physical features, formation and characteristics. How many physical features of India, that is formation and characteristics. Then unit four is hunter gatherers, then archaeological perspectives, origin of agriculture and domestication of animals, how the people were living in a caves, and the paint, the rocks, art, then their tools, weapons, and origin of agriculture, how they cultivated lands, then domestication of animals, how they domesticated those animals who have produced milk, and hunting also. Then unit 5 is Harappan civilization, that is the Indus Valley civilization by R.D. Banerjee, Dharam Sahni, and Dr. John Marshall, their geographical sphere, their bhogalika avasthiti. Then their decline, how to decline. Then Harappan civilization material characteristics from Harappan sites. Then unit 7 is the Chalcolithic and early iron age. Chalcolithic means that is called copper age. Then early Vedic society. Then changes in the later Vedic phase. Then Janapadas, Mahajanapadas. There is a 16 Mahajanapadas. Kasi Kosala, Anga, Magadha, Biji, Malla, Chedi, Vansa, Kuru, Panchala, Asmaka, Surasana, Avanti, Kandhara, Kamboja. That is the 16 Mahajanapadas. Then Buddhism, Jainism, and other religious ideas. That is the Buddhism, Four Noble Truths. Then Ashtanga Marga. Then Jainism have also Tri Ratna. And society and economy. Then Alexander invasion, and the battle Hydaspes, the battle of Hydaspes in 3 to 6 BC near river Jhelum. And then establishment of Mauryan rule and Magadhan territorial expansion. That is called Chandragupta Maurya defeated the last Nanda king Dhananda and occupied the throne of Magadha with the help of his chief minister Kautilya, known as Chanakya, known as Vishnugupta, wrote Arthashastra. And then administrative organization, the sources of the Mauryan rule is Arthashastra of Kautilya. He wrote about administrative organization, economy and society. And then there is a Greek ambassador, Megasthenes, wrote Indica, Strabo, Arian, also there. Then early state formation and Deccan and Tamilaham. We have also read Tamilaham. And today that is Agrarian society, and then Tamil language and literature. Today is the last class, and We have a question hour, so please ask me some questions, your doubts about the this chapter BHIC 131. Total they have 17 unit. That is, we have discussed earlier. You have asked me some question or we have ending our class. Can you hear me? Ask some question about unit 1 to 17. Unit 1 is sources of Indian history. Then second is archaeology as a source and prominent archaeological sites. Then third is Indian history, that is physical features, formation and characteristics. Then unit 4 is hunter-gatherers, archaeological perspectives, origin of agriculture and domestication of animals. Then fifth is Harappan civilization, that is chronology, geographical spread, diffusion and decline. Then unit 6 is Harappan civilization, materials characteristics, nature of contest, society and religion. Then unit 7 is Chalcolithic and Aram, early Iron Age. Then unit 8 is early Vedic society. Then changes in the later Vedic society. Then unit 10 is Janapadas, Mahajanapadas, there is 16 Mahajanapadas. Then unit 11 is Buddhism, Jainism as a religious ideas. Then unit 12 is Alexander invasion. Then 13 is establishment of Mauryan rule and Magadhan territorial expansion. Magadha was one of the Mahajanapadas. Then unit 14, that is the administrative organization, economy and society. Then 15 is early state formation of Deccan and Tamilaham. Then unit 16 is agrarian settlements, agrarian society, expansion of trade and urban centers, Peninsular India, that is South India, and growth of Tamil language and literature, that is called Unit 1 to 17. We have already discussed. So from Unit 1 to 17, you have no any questions? All is clear? So the class is over.